dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home.
Out of your own dream, you brought us and all creation into being. You spoke, and a great storm arose, and the land and the sea separated, and then you whispered, and the waves became quiet. Our ancestors stood on the shore and dreamed of what must lie beyond the horizon. And that dream drove them down to the sea, bound for destinations unknown. Some dreamed of fortune, some of adventure, and some dreamed of freedom and opportunity. And here we are, O God, in this land that they came to, in this great harbor, in this great city, in this great country, and we give you thanks. We give thanks for your dream and for ours. We celebrate not just our existence, but this nation in which you placed us, surrounded by tall ships and tall buildings. We remember the tall dreams and hopes that brought our grandparents and great-grandparents to these shores. We cherish the memory of their courage and boldness, and we cherish this land of freedom and opportunity. Inspired and strengthened by your dreams, dear God, we wish for a time when all people will be free, and to that end ask that you keep safe our native land and all nations who love their people, that we might all be beacons shining forth in the darkest parts of the world, bringing hope into human hearts who reside there. This is our prayer, and this is our dream. Amen.
Color guard, retire the colors. Mr. President, Secretary Cohen, Madam Attorney General, Secretary Danzig, Admiral Natter, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. In 1992, Emil Buss Mosbacher and Walter Cronkite asked their longtime friend and fellow Operation Sail board member, Charles Robertson, for a favor. Would Charles mind stepping in and serving as interim chairman of the organization? 8 years later, Mr. Robinson is still the volunteer chairman of Operation Sail, and it is his endless energy that has helped make Operation Sail 2000 the extraordinary event it is today. Ladies and gentlemen, Please welcome OpSail's unflagging leader, Charles Robertson.
President John F. Kennedy, whose vision and love for the sea created Operation Sail in 1961, said, "The sight of so many ships gathered from distant corners of the world for Operation Sail should remind us that strong..." "disciplined and adventuresome men can still find their way safely across uncertain and stormy seas." 24 years later, President Ronald Reagan had these words: "Bringing together the major tall ships of the world under the torch of liberty will provide dramatic focus on the principles of goodwill which we as a nation have embraced from our very beginnings." Today, these ships, flying the flags of nearly 50 countries, lift our hearts and empower our spirit as they offer an unforgettable vision of peace and harmony in the new millennium. For me, it has been a great honor and privilege to be part of this extraordinary display of international goodwill that reminds all of us of our rich and enduring maritime heritage. On this glorious day and on this great ship, my heart beats proud to be a citizen of our great United States of America. We are, after all, the land of the free and the home of the brave. Mr. President, I present to you and declare Operation Sail 2000 now underway. God bless America.
Ladies and gentlemen, the first vessel in the OpSail 2000 parade of sail is the United States Coast Guard Bark Eagle. The United States Coast Guard Bark Eagle is the flagship of OpSail 2000. Eagle is the only active commissioned sailing vessel in the U.S. Maritime Service. Built in 1936, Eagle is a 290-foot, three-masted bark. She bears a name that goes back to the early history of the United States' oldest continuing seagoing service. The first Eagle was commissioned in 1792, just 2 years after the formation of the Revenue Marine, the forerunner of today's Coast Guard. Coincidental with the parade of sail is the joint military flyover, which involves 29 aircraft from the United States Navy, the Marines, the Air Force, and Coast Guard, as well as from several foreign countries. Coming in from left to right, United States Marine Corps AV-8 Harrier. The flyover began this afternoon with four Navy F-18 Hornets from Strike Fighter Squadrons 15 and 87, the lead F-18 was flown by Captain Dave Mercer, Deputy Commander of Carrier Air Wing 8, which includes most of the naval aircraft flying here today. Following the initial flyover were F-14 Tomcats from the Top Hatters of Fighter Squadron 14 and the Black Aces from Fighter Squadron 41. Following the U.S. Coast Guard Bark Eagle in the parade of sail was the Danmark, a three-masted, full-rigged ship from Denmark, built as a training ship for cadet officers in the Danish Merchant Navy until World War II. Danmark made regular training voyages when, at the onset of the war, she was in New York and was instructed not to return. The ship served as a training vessel for the U.S. Coast Guard for the balance of the war. Pogoria, a 45-foot vessel, three-masted schooner, holds the distinction of being the first completed square rigger by Polish naval architect Zygmunt Koryn. Built for the Steelworkers Union in 1980, she has served as the background for a movie and as a floating classroom for West Island College of Quebec. The ship is equipped with all modern facilities and technological advances to accommodate students. She is the flagship of the Polish Sail Training Association in Gdansk. Coming in from the left above, the next planes in our flyover schedule are S-3 Vikings from the Scouts of VS-24. Coming abreast of Kennedy, flying the national ensign, is the Niagara, a two-masted brig from the United States. Niagara is a reconstruction of Commodore Oliver Hazard Perry's flagship, in which he won the Battle of Lake Erie in the War of 1812. She is owned and operated by the Erie Maritime Museum in Erie, Pennsylvania. She is a square-rigged, two-masted warship, originally armed with 18 carronades and two long guns. She is 198 feet long with all her spars and has a crew of 40 officers and sailors. Her complement in 1813 was 155 officers and crew. E2C Hawkeye. We mentioned earlier that the naval aircraft provided for the flyover today were from Carrier Air Wing 8. Carrier Air Wing 8 first operated on June 1, 1943 at NAS Norfolk, Virginia. Since World War II, CVW 8 has been assigned to the Atlantic Fleet, making numerous deployments with both the 2nd and 6th Fleets, as well as three deployments with 1st and 7th Fleets. The Air Wing has been embarked on USS Intrepid, USS Bunker Hill, USS Coral Sea, USS Lake Champlain, USS Forrestal, USS Shangri-La, USS America, USS Carl Vinson, USS Nimitz, USS Abraham Lincoln, USS Theodore Roosevelt, and USS John F. Kennedy. The Air Wing is currently assigned to the USS Enterprise and is commanded by Captain Jack Yukon Gadlewski. Operation SAIL is a national nonprofit foundation founded in 1961 by President Kennedy. Operation SAIL and its programs have had the support of every president since President Kennedy. OpSail was created to promote the use of tall ships as centers of learning to ports around America. Operation SAIL promotes cultural exchanges and goodwill through the medium of SAIL training and throughout its international tall ship programs. This learning shall encompass everything from SAIL training to America's maritime history. OpSail believes that every person in America should understand the importance of the ship, the ocean, and waterways in our nation's history. We value people who give back to the community through SAIL training programs shipbuilding and educational programs built around the ship. C-130 Hercules, next plane in our joint military flyover. The next Class A ship in the parade of sail comes to us from Ecuador. The Gaias is a three-masted bark, 262 feet in length. It was built in Spain in 1977 for the Ecuadorian Naval School in Guayaquil. She is named in memory of the first steamship to be built in South America in 1841. She has a 35-foot beam and 14-foot draft, bark-ribbed, with 17,000 square feet of sail. She accommodates 180 people. From VP-10, P-3 Orion aircraft approaching from the left as part of the joint military flyover. Now passing in review the Gaias, three-masted bark from Ecuador. Gaias, Ecuador. Just a reminder, ladies and gentlemen, that many of these vessels will be berthed in New York City at various locations starting on Wednesday from 10 to 6 p.m. For ship visiting. And if you would like an opportunity to visit one of these fine vessels, you can do so at that time. We'd also remind you to exercise caution and to take advantage of the water that's available behind the bleachers on the flight deck. Please try to avoid dehydration. Also, please try to avoid overexposure to the sun. There are medical people on hand to provide assistance if needed. The U.S. Coast Guard is represented next in the joint military flyover. An HC-130 Hercules, an HH-60 Jayhawk, and a Falcon jet in the U.S. Coast Guard. Okay.
American post-American Revolution.
Built in Lunenburg, Nova Scotia, the Rose is a Coast Guard certified Class A sail training vessel operated by the nonprofit HMS Rose Foundation. She carries a full complement of 49 crew members, including trainees. The Rose. Now moving into view from the left, the sail of the parade of sail continues with the N.E. Sagres, a three-masted bark from Portugal. The Sagres is a sister ship to the Eagle and is a 293-foot bark which was captured by America in 1945, handed over to Brazil in 1948, and then bought by Portugal in 1962. She is now a training ship for cadets for the Portuguese Navy, visiting the world, and sometimes taking on board cadets from other Portuguese-speaking countries. At Rouen in 1989 and 1994, she was one of the most visited ships, with a record of nearly 25,000 people on board in a single day. When under sail, Sagres is most easily recognized by the red Maltese crosses on her sails. Bearing in from the left, four F-15C Eagles, the world's premier air-to-air fighters from the United States Air Force 1st Fighter Wing, Langley, Virginia. In 1999, OpSail 2000 initiated a relationship with noted artist Peter Max to be the official artist of OpSail 2000. As a pop culture 20th century artist, Max and his work uphold the same ideals shared by Operation Sail, those being appreciation for cultural diversity, education, and environmental awareness. He is also known for his 4th of July work, which portrays the Statue of Liberty, an element which stands out prominently in his work commemorating OpSail 2000. Today, Mr. Max presents an original remarked image of his OpSail artwork to President Clinton. Now passing center ship, once again the N.E. Sagres, three-masted bark from Portugal.
Why don't we give you a call It's the Red Cross, by God.
With the Sagres circa 1945 passing in review, we call your attention to the left and the United States Air Force B-2 Spirit Bomber. B-2 Spirit is a multi-role bomber capable of delivering both conventional and nuclear munitions. A dramatic leap forward in technology, the bomber brings massive firepower to bear. In a short time, anywhere on the globe, through previously impenetrable defenses. Its low observable or stealth characteristics give it the ability to penetrate enemy defenses and threaten even the most heavily defended targets. And that concludes the joint military flyover for INR OpSail 2000. Please give a nice round of applause to the men and women who make up the squadrons in the United States Navy, Marines, Air Force, and Coast Guard who have been represented here today. In addition to that, our friends in the various squadrons and organizations that are represented from Carrier Air Wing 8, our great and deep appreciation for their participation in OpSail INR 2000. Schelde is the last remaining representative of a large fleet of schooners that sailed under the Dutch flag at the beginning of the 20th century. As the largest restored Dutch sailing ship, the Oosterschelde is a monument for Dutch shipbuilding and maritime navigation under sail. Oosterschelde now cruises the world as a floating embassy representing the city of Rotterdam. Ladies and gentlemen, in just a few moments, the President participate in reenlistment activities on board the USS John F. Kennedy for some of the members of the crew. And we would like to recognize those crew members for you at this time. They are PN2SW Keith Williams, AMS1 AWSW Frederick Carter, AD3 Davidson Gakey, AS3 Jose Jamisdell, AD1 AW Clyde Legrone, ABF1 AW Miguel Dancero, ABH1 AW Ricky Fisher, ABE2 Geraldine Lopez, ABH1 AWSW Ronald Spears, DTCS SWAW Christopher Collins, DT2 SW Michael Stanley, EM3 Lorenzo Allen, IC2 SW Francis Carania III, IC2 SWAW Richardson Lewis, IC2 SW Tijuana Young, HM1 SWAW FMF Christopher Barber, HM3 SWAW Rachel Martinez, AC2 Hector Mercado, and there are others. I call your attention to the parade of sail, where the Kalmar Nickel, three-masted full-rigged ship from the United States, passes in review. Built in 1977 in Wilmington, Delaware, the Kalmar Nickel is a full-scale reproduction of the first Swedish vessel to arrive in Delaware, then called New Sweden, in 1683. The full-rigged ship is just over 97 feet in length and weighs in at 180 tons, the Kalmar Nickel. Also part of the JFK Presidential Reenlistment Ceremony this morning, STG-2 SW Donald White, BM-1 SW Stephen Milrez, SH-2 Aaron Johnson, SH-1 SW Christopher Jones, PCSN Dora Juarez, AK-2 SWAW Kenneth Negron, and we would like to recognize them all for their commitment to the United States Navy and to the United States of America.
Raise your right hand. Say, I speak your name and repeat after me. Do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that I will obey the orders of the President of the United States and the orders of the officers appointed over me, in accordance with Navy regulations and the Uniform Code of Military Justice. So help me God. Congratulations.
Kennedy, who have reenlisted aboard here today. Now passing in review in the parade of sail, the Europa, a three-masted bark from the Netherlands. Launched in Hamburg in 1911 as Senator Brockes, she was used as a lightship in the mouth of the Elbe until the 1970s. We also call your attention now to the program area, where new recruits are about to be sworn into the United States Navy by our Commander-in-Chief. Those new recruits are Jacqueline Acevedo, Natalie Caceres, Christopher Conti, James DeLuca, David DeLuca, Wayne Elserby, Pedro Estrada, Timothy Heron, Tarek Missouri, Stephen Newton, Ernie Rosado, and William Wilkin.
Raise your right hand. Say aye, speak your name. Do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, That I will obey the orders of the President of the United States and the orders of the officers appointed over me. In accordance with Navy regulations and the Uniform Code of Military Justice. So help me God. Congratulations.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of the United States Navy, we're recognizing the efforts of the present and future leaders of this fine fighting force. Passing in review in the OpSail 2000 parade of sail now is the Gazela of Philadelphia, a three-masted barkentine from the United States. She was built in Portugal in 1883. This 187-foot barkentine worked at the Grand Banks fishing grounds off Newfoundland for nearly a century before her acquisition and spectacular restoration by the Ship Preservation Guild of Philadelphia. She is the oldest and largest wooden square rigger still in active service. Gazela of Philadelphia can even boast about a career in the movies. She was used in the movie Interview with a Vampire and now serves as the Maritime Goodwill Ambassador to national and international events for the city of Philadelphia and Camden, New Jersey. Additionally, she hosts programs on ship preservation, sail training, and marine science, and serves as a museum of sailing ship technology.
Good morning. On behalf of the Immigration and Naturalization Service, I'd like to welcome you to this naturalization ceremony. The presence of President Clinton, the First Lady, the Attorney General, and other dignitaries underscores the importance of this event. But the most important people here today are those who are about to take the Oath of Allegiance. Because of them, the United States will be 19 citizens richer today. As Deputy Commissioner of the Immigration and Naturalization Service, it's always an honor for me to welcome new citizens. But today, I am doubly honored. First of all, we are here in New York Harbor, the home of the Statue of Liberty, which serves as a symbol of this great nation's unique willingness to open its golden door to those who yearn to breathe free. Secondly, today is July the 4th, a day in which we celebrate the ideals and principles which form the foundation of our nation, and a day in which we rededicate ourselves to those ideals and principles so that we ensure that America continues to serve as a beacon of hope and opportunity for all. The Attorney General will now administer the Oath of Allegiance to our new citizens.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Honorable Janet Reno, Attorney General of the United States of America.
Raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, and repeat your name, hereby declare on oath that I absolutely and entirely renounce and abjure all allegiance and fidelity to any foreign prince, potentate, state, or sovereignty of which I have heretofore been a subject or citizen. that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that I will bear arms on behalf of the United States when required by the law, that I will perform non-combatant service in the armed forces of the United States when required by the law, that I will perform work of national importance under civilian direction when required by the law, and that I take this obligation freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion. So help me God. Congratulations and welcome.
President will join us. We're going to administer the, we're going to say the Pledge of Allegiance, the new citizens, and then we're going to provide them certificates.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, with indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And Mr. President, if you will hand out their certificates, or not hand out, we will give them their certificates and you can walk them.
Good.
So, Mr.
passing in review as part of the OpSail 2000 parade of review, the Kaiwo Maru four-masted bark from Japan. The Kaiwo Maru is a 361-foot four-masted bark built for the Institute of Sea Training. The original King of the Sea was built in 1930. In its 59 years of service, the first vessel sailed the equivalent of 49 times around the earth, educating more than 11,000 trainees. The new ship was built in 1989 using funds from both the government and from private donations. The Kaiwo Maru, four-masted bark from Japan. Thank you. We remind you, ladies and gentlemen, to please remain seated during the course of the program, unless, of course, you feel the need for water, which is available on the flight deck behind the bleachers, or medical attention, which is also available near the bleachers throughout the flight deck of the USS John F. Kennedy. Please do not allow yourself to succumb to the problems of the heat and the sun, which are quite prevalent here today. So the services are available to you if you need them. However, we would ask you to please remain in your seats for the duration of this morning's program.
Hey, remarks getting ready to start. Three into the ball.
Now coming to beam Kennedy is the Chesney Bronco, a three-masted full-rigged ship from Brazil. Chesney Bronco is Portuguese for white swan. It's a three-masted tall ship serving the Brazilian Navy as a sail training vessel and international representative. Currently, she is making a commemorative journey, 500 years of Brazil, sailing from Lisbon, Portugal, to Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. Capitan Miranda from Uruguay, three-masted staysail schooner. She served her nation's navy for more than two decades. She was purchased as a hydrographic survey vessel during the 1960s and given a modern schooner rig in 1978. Her crew consists of 40 men and 33 cadets, overseen by 11 officers. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my honor to introduce your host for today's historic International Naval Review, the 71st Secretary of the Navy. The Secretary heads the Department of the Navy, all 675,000 sailors and Marines, 200,000 civilian Navy employees, 315 warships, and 4,100 aircraft. Please join in welcoming the Secretary of the Navy, the Honorable Richard Danzig.
Well, thank you, President Clinton, Mrs. Clinton. It's a great honor for me to introduce the Secretary of Defense, William Cohn. You have seen today an extraordinary display of naval warships, clipper ships from an age gone by, military aircraft, citizens being sworn in, Broadway shows. In the light of this, I think I'll be brief. It's a great pleasure for me, particularly, to introduce Secretary Cohn in a context like this one on board a naval ship. One of the greatest virtues that the U.S. Navy brings to bear, and the Marine Corps with it, is an ability to represent us, the United States, throughout the world. Three-quarters of this globe is covered by seas, and as a result, we have a reach that really is global. The over 70% of the population of the world is within 200 miles of the sea, and our missiles and our aircraft have capabilities of reaching out over 1,000 miles. We are able to exert power and influence on behalf of the United States everywhere, and it gives to the United States a sense of presence throughout the globe that I think is very material. At the same time, we pride ourselves on our adaptability. The fact that the same naval ships that are such powerful instruments of war you see today in cooperation with other navies, because we are so able to perform missions of peace as well as missions of war, and to do so cooperatively with so many other countries. These same characteristics, the adaptiveness and the ability to project a sense of presence, are very evident in the qualities of Secretary of Defense Bill Cohn. From a background as a mayor of Bangor, and then 6 years in Congress as a representative and 18 years as a senator, Bill Cohn brings very rich attributes to the job of Secretary of Defense. But a transition like that requires extraordinary characteristics of adaptability as you move from the legislative branch to the executive branch and orchestrate not just your own activities, but those of the over a million people in the Department of Defense, and throughout the administration, a coordination that's a very delicate and important one. Secretary Cohn has made that transition with extraordinary grace and power, and it is, in my view, in the best naval tradition. He has also demonstrated and carried forward a U.S. presence throughout the world. I asked his staff before this introduction how many miles they thought he traveled. And we computed that if he had worked 5 days a week, which he works more than that, but 5 days a week throughout his term, he's traveled on average 1,000 miles a day representing the United States everywhere in the world, and has relationships with heads of state and ministers of defense in over 50 countries, which give to us extraordinary power throughout the world. So I would say that the Navy's virtues of presence and adaptation are virtues you see incarnate in this extraordinary leader. And it's my great privilege, particularly on a ship, to introduce to you our Secretary of Defense, William Cohn. Thank you.
Secretary Danzig, thank you very much for your kind comments. Annie, let me thank the two of you for the energy and the vision that you have brought to our Navy during these past several years. You've just done an outstanding job. And the Navy is deeply proud of you, and we're proud of the job you do on behalf of the Navy, so thank you. President Clinton and First Lady, Mrs. Clinton, Chelsea, welcome. Attorney General Reno, Secretary Slater, Captain Miller, Admiral Natter, Deputy Secretary De Leon and Ann, and Janet, members of the Armed Forces, and distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. What a great day. What a great day that we have arranged for us to celebrate this birthday of ours. And I think it's quite fitting, as we gather this year, the first year of a new century and a new millennium, on this magnificent carrier named after our 35th president. President Kennedy not only served in the Navy, but was one of his greatest champions in the last century, a century that began with freedom in doubt and ended with freedom flourishing. Indeed, I think if President Kennedy for this spectacular vista, to pay tribute and express our thanks for the service and sacrifice of the sailors, the Marines, and the Coast Guardsmen who have made this event possible. But just as importantly, for the service and sacrifice of the tens of thousands of men and women in uniform, on sea, on land, as you saw in the air, who are representing and defending our nation throughout the world today. And indeed, at this very moment, there are some 53,000 American sailors who are serving the world over in a dozen different exercises and operations, such as Southern Watch in the Persian Gulf, and making port visits in 10 different nations from Spain to Singapore. All of them, and you can witness this from the stunning display that you see here today, take an immense and well-justified pride in the power and the precision of America's armed forces. And they recognize that their calling is not only worthwhile, it is noble. It is the call to be part of the strongest force for peace and stability in the history of mankind. The liberty that we enjoy today, on this day and on every day, is not a gift of fate guaranteed forever. It's a legacy of responsibility that demands eternal commitment and renewal. Our freedom flows directly from the hands, the hard work, and the hard-won victories of men and women in uniform. And I've had the privilege for the past 3.5 years to see that drive and discipline and dedication every day as Secretary of Defense. And I am overjoyed that you now have the chance, and the American people have the chance who are watching this, to have the chance to see such a magnificent display of that power, that precision, that pride on behalf of all of us who are here today. Thank you very much, the men and women who are serving us. We frequently say this, but we deeply believe it. We have the finest military in the history of the world. There is no one that can match our training, no one can match our technology, but most of all, no one can match the character and the courage of our servicemen and women. And we are committed to sustaining that force so that it defends our liberties in this century, just as it defended the liberties of Americans and all of our allies in the past century. Now, more than 50 years ago, toward the end of the Second World War, a renowned judge, Leonard Hand, came here to New York City, and he spoke to a group of newly sworn-in citizens. And he talked about how those new citizens were more than simply pledging their allegiance to our democracy, as we saw just a few moments ago. He said they were reaffirming the meaning of and paying honor to the suffering and the sacrifice of those who had gone before them in that cause. The dual ceremony that we have just witnessed, the swearing in of new citizens followed by a reenlistment of our sailors, is a very vivid and eloquent restatement of that principle. And Judge Hand went on to say that the responsibility of Americans to defend liberty would not end with the sound of the guns. It required a fidelity to the spirit of liberty, which seeks to understand the minds of other men and women, which weighs their interests alongside its own without bias. The spirit of liberty embodies the lesson that mankind has never learned, but has never quite forgotten, that there may be a kingdom where the least shall be heard and considered side by side with the greatest. I mention his words today because today we are honoring that principle, because in just a few moments, we are going to be privileged to hear from an extraordinary young woman who represents those ideas and ideals. From a life of deprivation in Honduras, she immigrated to the United States right here to New York just 7 years ago. And like so many people inspired by the possibility and the promise and the potential of life in America, she was in search of an education, in search of a better way of life. And she found that, not only here in this city, but here on board this ship. Seaman Rosa Norales Nunez graduated from the Jane Addams High School in the Bronx last spring. She enlisted in the U.S. Navy last August. And just a few moments ago, She made one of the most profound and noble pledges she'll ever make in her life. She took the oath to become a citizen of the United States. She may be one of the newest citizens among us, but she has embraced that spirit of liberty as much as you or I. And it's a great tribute to the generosity and spirit of America that she not only is able to share the same platform with our most foremost citizen, our Commander-in-Chief, but that she is welcomed here and she is honored by all of you who are here. Ladies and gentlemen, that is truly the spirit of liberty, the spirit of America. Judge Hand, in that remarkable speech of his, said that liberty lies in the hearts of men and women. And when it dies there, there is no statute, no law, no regulation, indeed no constitution that can save it. But as long as it lives there, there's no need for any law or regulation or constitution to save it. It is now my pleasure to introduce to you a person who represents the pride of our Navy, and indeed the pride of our nation, who represents that spirit of liberty that lies deep in her heart, Seaman Rosa Norales Nunez.
Secretary Cohen, for introducing me. It is such an honor to be here today with the President, the First Lady, and all the other estimated guests. I am a little overwhelmed today by this honor and all the other attention I have received. This is my first hour as a United States citizen, and I am so proud to finally be an American. As a small child growing up in the countryside of Honduras, as a teenager living in the Bronx, I would never have guessed that someday I would be here in uniform as a sailor of the United States Navy, as an American citizen, and introducing the President of the United States. I still can't believe this. This is a very special day for America, and I am proud to share it with all of you. From now on, July 4th will always be special to me. Not only as the birthday of my country, but also as the birthday of my citizenship. I am very proud to be a member of the crew of USS John F. Kennedy and the Navy. I'm also proud of all my shipmates who work very hard to serve our country well. One day, I hope to continue my service in the Navy as a naval recruiter, to share my great experience and at the same time, motivate the young people to serve this Navy. I have been given the privilege of introducing the President of my new country, and I am honored to introduce my Commander-in-Chief, the Honorable William Jefferson Clinton.
Let me say, if Seaman Rosa Norales Nunez gets much more practice, she can start running for office in her new country someday. Wasn't she terrific? Let's give her another hand. I thought she was great. I would like to also welcome the other new citizens, and we swore in a few moments ago, and I ask you to give them a hand, too. They come from all over the world. Hillary and Chelsea and I are honored to be here with all of you. Secretary and Mrs. Cohen, Attorney General Reno, Secretary Slater, Ambassador and Mrs. Holbrooke, Secretary Danzig, Mrs. Danzig. To the members of the Congress who are here, I know that Senator Levin and Senator Dodd and former Senator John Glenn are back there behind me, and I saw Senator Lautenberg out in the audience, and there are a lot of other members of Congress here. I'd like to ask all the members of Congress to stand and be recognized. I saw a half a dozen. Representative Chloe Miller, thank you. Thank you all for being here. I'd also like to recognize the currently reigning Miss America, Heather French, who has made the welfare of our veterans her great cause this year. Heather, stand up and be recognized. Thank you for being here. And I would like to recognize also, because President Kennedy started this event, I would like to thank Caroline Kennedy Schlossberg and Ed Schlossberg and their three wonderful children for being here today. And welcome to all of you. And I would like to thank Chairman Robertson and his wife. You know, he told me when he got up here and opened this, that's the first public speech he had ever made. I think he did a pretty good job, don't you? And besides that, he produced all these ships. So give him a hand. Thank you. I want to thank all the men and women in uniform who are here and all of those who have come here from other nations to be a part of the International Naval Review and Operation SAIL. I want to thank Captain Mike Miller, the officers and the crew of the JFK especially. I know they had to turn to make this day possible. For all of you who are not familiar with the exploits of the USS John F. Kennedy, let me tell you that from the Atlantic to the Red Sea, to the Mediterranean, to the Arabian Gulf, this great ship has more than met its mission. It has proved truly worthy of its heroic and noble name. Let me also say today that there is another heroic name we honor today. I am especially pleased to announce that the United States Navy will designate its newest class of ship, the Zumwalt class, in honor of Admiral Elmo Bud Zumwalt. And I would like to ask his wife, Musa, and his son and other family members to stand today and be recognized. Let's give them a big hand. Thank you. God bless you. Admiral Zumwalt passed away just 2 days into this new century. He was my mentor, my friend, and a magnificent role model. He was a friend and a passionate advocate for every sailor in his beloved Navy. His deeply, profoundly moral leadership will shape the character and conscience of our Navy for generations to come. And all America salutes him today. He deserves to have a class of ships named after him. When he passed away, one of the naval aides who works for me in the White House, who happens to be a Filipino-American and has been in the United States Navy for 30 years, looked at me with tears in his eyes and he said, "Admiral Zumwalt was our admiral. He cared about all of us." And today we honor him in this way. I just want to say one or two other things about this important day for the Navy and for all Americans. On this day, which we commemorate because of what happened in Independence Hall with the Declaration of Independence, the greatest hero of our Revolution was not in Philadelphia, but instead was here on Manhattan Island, preparing his outnumbered army for battle. Staring out over the very waters where we sit today, General George Washington saw the British warships landing at Staten Island, the vanguard of the largest expeditionary force ever launched by the British Empire. As the armies eyed each other across this channel, the Declaration of Independence arrived from Philadelphia. George Washington ordered it to be read aloud to the troops. It was at the tip of Manhattan Island, just to our north, where the troops first heard they were actually citizens of a new nation, where they first heard the words, "We hold these truths to be self-evident," and where they first pledged their lives, their fortunes, their sacred honor. The Patriots of 1776 took these colonies and made out of them a country. They took a vision of liberty and made it into the law of this land. To a world that knew rule only by kings and lords, America's creed confounded the imagination. In the words of one British loyalist, "If the people be the governors, who shall be the governed?" America's answer was, "The governors and the governed must be one and the same." More than two centuries later, for the first time in all of history, more than half of the people of this globe live under governments of their own choosing. An astonishing long way we have come since this day in 1776. Just behind me on Ellis Island, the ancestors of more than 100 million United States citizens took their first steps on America's soil. They are the forebears of the immigrants who took the oath of citizenship today. Pulled by the vision of liberty and opportunity, often pushed by forces of intolerance and hopelessness, they came and brought with them their skills, their knowledge, and their heart. For more than a century, those who came through this gateway have passed a statue as large as the ideal for which it stands. "She was beautiful with the early morning light," said one young woman fleeing tyranny from Eastern Europe. "The whole boat bent toward her because everybody went out, everybody was in the same spot, and everybody was crying." One Greek immigrant remembers looking up at the Statue of Liberty and asking her, "Please give me the chance to become someone in America." Lady Liberty, like those whom she welcomed, was also an immigrant, a gift from France, a nation which did so much to help to give us birth. Perhaps more than any other nation in all history, we have drawn our strength and spirit from people from other lands, bearing different memories, bringing diverse traditions. Immigrants have enriched our culture, enhanced our economy, broadened our vision of the world. And that is why on this 4th of July, standing in the shadow of Lady Liberty, we must resolve anyone who accepts the rights and responsibilities of citizenship is our fellow citizen, equal in the eyes of God, entitled to be treated equally and with dignity by all of us. That must be our resolution on this and every Independence Day. In 1827, 51 years after the Declaration of Independence was signed, the sole surviving signer of the Declaration was Charles Carroll of Maryland. He wrote the following: "I recommend to the future generation the principles of the Declaration as the best earthly inheritance their ancestors could bequeath. All of us are created equal, all endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights, among them life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." You may have noted that last week it was my great honor to announce on behalf of our common endeavors with our British and Japanese and other counterparts that the first rough map of the human genome has been decoded. We now know that there will be an explosion of scientific discoveries which may give the young children in this audience a life expectancy of 100 years. But one thing we have already learned that proved the wisdom of the founders is that genetically, without regard to race, we are 99.9% the same, and that the genetic differences of individuals within each racial and ethnic group are greater than the genetic differences of one group to another. It is important that we remember that after all, the founding fathers were pretty smart, and that science has confirmed what they said so long ago. The really difficult thing is to confirm what they said in our everyday lives. Remember this fine young woman who introduced me today and resolved to make the creed of our declaration the reality in all of our lives. Thank you, and God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my pleasure to introduce to you the reigning Miss America, Heather French. Miss America is the daughter of a disabled Vietnam veteran, and her Miss America platform is the Forgotten Heroes, honoring our nation's homeless veterans. So it is indeed appropriate that she is with us here today. Please welcome Miss America 2000, Miss Heather French.
Hello. Happy 4th of July. Thank you and good afternoon, Mr. President, Mrs. Clinton, Chelsea, Secretary Cohen, Mrs. Cohen, Madam Attorney General, Secretary Danzig, and distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, our servicemen and women, and especially our veterans who are in the audience today. That's right, they deserve an applause. It is my great pleasure to introduce our Best of Broadway finale. The International Naval Review and Operation SAIL 2000 are proud to welcome the Broadway inspirational voices under the direction of Michael McElroy. The newly formed group is made up of singers presently performing on Broadway. Some of the shows represented include Jesus Christ Superstar, Aida, Les Miserables, Rent, Beauty and the Beast, Kiss Me Kate, The Lion King, The Music Man, and Cabaret. You may have seen them perform the opening number of the 2000 Tony Awards with Rosie O'Donnell. Please welcome the Broadway Inspirational Choir and their rendition of More Abundantly.
Thank you.
And now INR and OpSail 2000 are very proud to welcome 2000 Tony Award winner Miss Heather Headley, Adam Pascal, Cherie Renee Scott from the critically acclaimed Tony Award winning musical Aida. The first number features Cherie Renee Scott with Every Story. Maybe not. Heather, are they not doing that? You go ahead.
Pardon.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will continue with our program in just a moment. We might remind you that the parade of sail is continuing, and while the activities on board the USS John F. Kennedy have been continuing, we have been witnessing in the background a parade of truly spectacular vessels. Those vessels including the Esmeralda from Chile, the Simón Bolívar from Venezuela, the Dar Mochetny from Poland, Libertad from Argentina, Dewaruchi from Indonesia, the Americo Vespucci from Italy, and the Gorsch Folk from Germany. Currently passing in review before the USS John F. Kennedy is the Juan Sebastian del Elcano, a four-masted steel-hulled topsail schooner built in 1927. Please welcome Adam Pascal and Heather Headley.
Sometimes in my darkest thoughts, I wish I'd never learned what it is to be in love and have that love returned.
Is it written in the stars?
I'll be paying for some crime. Is that all that we are good for? Just some stretch of mortal time.
Or some God's experiment in which we have no say, in which we're given paradise, but only
please welcome Sherry Renee Scott.
Life turned on its head.
did I slip and fall? How did I throw half a lifetime away without any thought at all? This should have been my time. It's over, it never began. I closed my eyes to so much for so long, and I no longer can. I try to blame it on fortune, some kind of shift in a star. But I know the truth, and it haunts me. It's flown just a little too far. I know the truth, and it mocks me. I know the truth, and it shocks me. It's flown just a little too far. Why do I want him still? Why, when there's nothing there? How to go on with the rest of my life? To pretend I don't care?
Ladies and gentlemen, Sherry Renee Scott.
Please welcome back Ms. Heather Headley.
And once again, please welcome back Ms. Heather Headley.
This is the moment when the gods expect me to beg for help, but I won't even try. I want nothing in the world but myself to protect me, and I won't lie down, roll over and die. All I have to do is forget how much I love you. All I have to do is put my longing to one side. Tell myself that love's an ever-changing situation. Passion would have cooled and all the magic would have died. I knew him.
to have lost him when the ties were barely binding. But at the contempt of the familiar cannot start. It's easy, it's easy. Until I think about him as he was when I last touched him. And how we would have been, why to be with him today. Those very rare occasions don't let up, they keep on calling. It's easy, it's easy as a lie. But then I see the faces of a worn, defeated people, a father and a nation. Things we've done, easy, so easy. And the more I think about him, till the earth draws it around of me. And though I choose to leave him for another kind of love, this is no denial, no betrayal.
Ladies and gentlemen, Heather Headley, Adam Pascal, and Sherry Renee Scott. From AIDA. And we're not finished yet. Our program continues as we present once again the Broadway Inspirational Choir under the direction of Michael McElroy with Lean on Me and Never Alone.
breakers dashing. Oh, yes, I have. They were trying, trying to conquer my
Oh,
The name says it all. The Broadway Inspirational Voices under the direction of Michael McElroy. Ladies and gentlemen, also a nice round of applause for our reigning Miss America, Heather French. That is my pleasure to once again call forward the Honorable Richard Danzig, Secretary of the Navy.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we conclude this event, I'd ask you to think about one thing. And that is how hot you were at various times this morning. I say that because it's worth thinking about what it is like for the sailors who work on these decks in, for example, the Persian Gulf, where the temperatures can be 30 and 40 degrees hotter than you experienced this morning, launching aircraft every 30 to 40 seconds. We all owe them a great debt of gratitude, and if you can express it to them both now and if you can express it to them in whatever way is appropriate to you as you go about your daily life by reaching out and saying thank you, that would be a wonderful thing and a wonderful result of today. Mr. President, Mrs. Clinton, Secretary Cohn, Madam Attorney General, Secretary Slater, distinguished members of Congress, it's been an honor to have you here today, and we thank you for being here. Members of the United States Navy, sailors all around the world, it's an honor for us that you are there, and we thank you very much. Take care. Have a happy and safe 4th of July.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the formal portion of our program. We would like to ask you all to remain seated. We're going to call on Lieutenant Commander Don Keller and the Atlantic Fleet Band for some additional entertainment. The guests of the President, Secretary Cohn, Secretary Danzig's family, will be departing via Elevator 1 shortly, and we would ask that you all remain seated until the official visitors have departed. And we will be departing the ship also on Elevator 1, but we will do it in sections because of the large crowd that we have here this afternoon. We want to make sure that everybody gets off the ship safely and in an orderly fashion.